This story on the video clips I'm going to show you is about Professor Joe Combs, Hyles teacher at Hyles Anderson College through the years. And this is one of the people, no doubt, at David Gibbs Jr. said, Giants yesterday and Giants today. So we're going to look at this film and you decide about Joe Combs, the child abuser, sex offender, a pedophile, whatever you want. And this is what Jack Hyles has produced over the years. And it just goes on and on and on, just like a snowball. It gets bigger and bigger and bigger.
We go back now to the Bible Belt and the story of a child kept as a servant in her own family. For years, her father, a Baptist minister, had managed to keep secret what was going on, but suspicions had begun to surface. And then, without warning, the girl vanished. Sylvia Chase picks up the story.
Faith is fundamental to the people who live in these hills and border towns along the Tennessee and Virginia line.
There ought to be something that you care about, that you want God to do.
When word began to circulate that Pastor Joe Combs might be in trouble with the law, he took his quarrel with the police to the airwaves.
I'm scared. My family's scared. We have seen so many crooked things done since last February. We have no reason to believe that justice will be done.
The conflict between the pastor and the detective escalated. And with Esther nowhere in sight, Detective Richmond had Combs ordered to court.
Mr. Combs testified under oath that she had ran away and he had no idea where she was at.
I didn't leave home. I was sent away. Joe sent me away because the police kept coming around.
Indeed, Esther hadn't run away. She was sent first to Charleston, South Carolina, to a fellow preacher's house, and then on to Watkinsville, Georgia, and the home of Susan and Roger Combs, Joe's brother. Experiencing normal family life for the first time, Esther felt confident enough to confide in her Aunt Susan. Out tumbled the long-held secrets of her tortured life.
Many, many, many nights, Esther and I would sit up. Basically, she would be crying, you know. But
it must have made you very angry.
Oh, yeah.
Esther was safe here, but still threatened by phone calls from Joe and Evangeline Combs, who said Esther was making it all up.
He said, she said that? And I said, yes. And I said, we believe her. He said, it's not true. You know, none of that happened.
And now you knew your brother was lying to you.
Oh, yeah. He knew it. I knew it. I know it.
She had been gone for 6 months, beyond the reach of the family that had hurt her so deeply.
We love you, Administrator.
Hoping that the detective back in Bristol still cared, Esther made a bid for survival. She called for help.
Out of the blue, she called me on the telephone from Georgia, and she said, I want to tell you everything that has happened to me from the time I was a baby.
Wow.
And I laid the phone down and I screamed because I knew that I could help her then.
Detective Richmond immediately drove to Georgia and in this home, in this room, began to hear the story of Esther's life, of her ordeal in the fellowship hall, home to the Combs where no one outside the family had been permitted. As we walked, Detective Richmond revealed that not only had Esther been brutally beaten, she had told the detective she was sexually abused as well, often in the men's bathroom.
A lot of the beatings occurred in here where she would be made to stand in a circle. She said one would beat her until that one got tired and then the other one would start beating her. She was beaten with ropes, chains, whips, umbrellas, bats, hammers.
Joe and Evangeline Combs were arrested in November of 1998, and Esther was there.
Debbie, let me come, because I wanted to see. I wanted them to see me. You know, Debbie hadn't done it. I had done it. I'm the one that told.
And what happened? Did you speak to them?
She come walking over to me and telling me how much she loved me and that I was her baby girl. I think it was the first time that she had said, I love you, that many times.
What did you say?
Every time she kept telling me that she loved me, I just kept telling her I didn't want her love. As much as I did, I'd always wanted it, I just kept telling her I didn't want it.
But even at that moment?
I wanted it.
Joseph and Evangeline Combs pled not guilty to charges unthinkable in this small town. Child abuse, kidnapping, rape. And their other children rose to their defense. Brothers Jimmy and David Combs and sister Cindy also denied any involvement in Esther's alleged abuse. So if your brothers and sisters say that they never saw you beaten,
then they're lying.
But the trial was approaching, and it would be Esther's word against the rest of her family, not the strongest of cases against a powerful preacher in a town of true believers. Prosecutors worried. Then an almost miraculous discovery in a curbside trash can. And now the dramatic conclusion to Sylvia Chase's story. Reverend Joe Combs and his wife Evangeline are about to go on trial charged with child abuse, kidnapping, and rape. And despite everything Esther has been through, prosecutors are not sure they can get a conviction. The case would have come down to Esther's word against the rest of her family had it not been for a totally unexpected break. By chance, a former cellmate of Evangeline Combs found critical evidence, recognizing the family in photos discarded in this curbside trash can, turning them into police. Photographs supporting Esther's story. Her hands bandaged after being burned, her eye blackened, her chin bruised, her other eye bruised and cut, all as she had said. And when Joseph and Evangeline Combs walked into court, people who had known them finally began to talk.
Did he ever tell you what Esther Combs' purpose was in life? Did Mr. Combs tell you that?
He said that God had created her to be a servant, and they were training her to serve.
Dozens of people have been interviewed by Detective Richmond, who believes they were afraid to challenge the preacher. Now, they testified about the nagging concerns they had for Esther. But no evidence spoke louder than the scars. 410 wounds. Scars upon scars.
She grabbed my skin with the pliers, pulled it, twisted it and pulled it out until it took it. She grabbed my teeth and shoved them back up in my mouth. And when I looked up, he just cracked the stick over my head and it started bleeding and I fell to the floor.
Esther sat, trembling through the questioning, at times shielding her eyes from the gaze of her parents. There was little attempt to rebut her testimony.
Did you or did you not give her a black eye?
Never.
For a few brief hours, Joseph Combs took the stand in his own defense. He denied all of Esther's accusations.
I'm bewildered by all of this. I can't get my mind around it. That doesn't make any sense.
Evangeline Combs did not testify. The defense team relied heavily on the testimony of the other Combs children. But in the end, it took the jury 3 hours to reach their verdicts.
You find the defendant, Joseph D. Combs, guilty of intentional or knowing aggravated assault.
Joe Combs was found guilty of assault, aggravated abuse, rape, and kidnapping. Evangeline Combs was guilty of multiple aggravated abuse charges. Wearing their prison stripes from the Sullivan County Jail, Joseph and Evangeline Combs came to court for sentencing. Joseph Combs was sentenced to a total of 106 years and was immediately led from the court. As Evangeline Combs awaited her sentencing, Esther Combs asked for the chance to speak directly to her parents one last time.
I just wish you could tell me what I did to make you hate me, because I loved you so much, even though you put me through hell, because I told myself you did it because you loved me.
Evangeline Combs would only stare back, emotionless, as Esther spoke. She would soon be sentenced to 65 years in prison.
I would have done anything for you. I would have moved mountains if I thought it would make you love me. That's how much I loved you. That's how much you hurt me.
After the trial, Esther made a fresh start.
Towels and sheets. Blankets.
Moving into a new apartment last month.
How are you?
And there are good people around. A boyfriend, Joe Sawyers, who is sharing her new life. There's the joy of a new job and a weekly paycheck from Walmart, where Esther works as a cashier.
You're fine.
And at 23, Esther is learning how to drive. Joe is a patient teacher.
So you need lettuce.
Yeah.
Detective Debbie Richmond says that Esther will always be like a daughter to her. They visit at least once a week.
Well, I've got to go to work. I'll see you. Bye. Bye.
She saved my life. She means the world to me. I can never repay her for what she did.
It's up to Esther now, who struggles daily with lingering pain and sorrow, and a persistent fear of her father, and longing for the love her mother denied her.
The memories are still so fresh. I mean, I smell a certain perfume, and I swear up and down she's behind me.
The damage is deep, but one day at a time, Esther is surviving, nurturing her tenuous hold on life. A life almost shattered in the name of family and in the name of faith.
This is the same person I'm talking about at the beginning of the video. And Dr. David Gibbs Jr. said about this, about Hyles answering at college in 2011, I think. Giants yesterday, Giants today. Clarence Sexton and Johnny Pope said this, the greatest church in history. Professor Joe Combs in prison for life, abusing his stepdaughter, as you seen on the video. You know, torture, and they abused that girl something awful. Joe Combs said this about Dr. Hyles. He was the greatest preacher in the world, and said he is praying one day. I prayed, dear brother Rice, dear brother Robertson, and dear brother God, I mean brother Hyles, I don't know why I'm admitting this, but I bowed my head and prayed, dear brother Hyles. Professor Joe Combs, Hyles Anderson College, quote, I believe that we have the privilege of being the greatest church, pastored by the greatest preacher that ever lived. You know, I believe Jesus said John the Baptist was the greatest preacher from a woman's womb. Amen. Have you ever heard of Jim Jones? This is what Hyles Anderson produced for years. And we've still got these people, on the bandwagon with him. Amen. And Dr. Hyles is a man. Had the world resting up on his shoulder. The man who could get toothpaste from God. Orange juice to drink when there's none around. He'd pray all night and win souls at the drop of a hat. And that had a deacon, I mean a teacher, I mean who would drink poison, orange juice, who commit, I mean, you know, he illustrated a story about the drinking orange juice and one old poor old dopey feller, I mean one of his school boys, professor, I mean said he would drink it. And he had one said he, commit suicide and jump off the Chicago River Bridge. And had one that would kiss the ground after a guru walked on, amen. And Dr. Tony Hudson said this with fear and with trembling, no doubt, at Faith Baptist Church in November count meeting, that Jack Hyles' name was not a curse word. Let me give you some Bible scripture. Bible said, Colossians 2:8, beware lest any man spoil you with philosophy and vain deceit after tradition of men and rudeness of the world, not after Christ, amen. And this is what the closing, Judy Nickshake Johnson, that's Jenny's and Vic's daughter, quote, "Jack Hyles made my brother and I a life, a living hell." Jack's daughter, own daughter, I mean, this Linda said this, her dad ran a cult church. You talk about fundamental seduction, and the Bible said evil men and seducers get worse and worse, and many shall fall to the pernicious ways, amen. You know, Jack Hyles, a womanizer, David Hyles, I mean, a sick fornicator and adulterer, Jack Schaap, you know the story about getting caught up on the cell phone, taking this little 16-year-old girl across the line, and we have these people saying, giants today, and science yesterday, and this is what Jack Hyles, I got a list a mile long, and people still falling after this man, been dead since 2001, still bragging, and still infected with his rotten doctrine, amen. America better wake up. America in terrible, awful shape. We find these people, just like, I mean, Jim Jones. Drunk Jim Jones Kool-Aid. And this is what people are still doing. They're fundamental Baptist churches today. Still associating themselves with Hyles Anderson College boys because of clout. And money. Money. You talk about money in Titus chapter 1, 10, 11. It tells us. I mean, Lord. Hey, wake up, folks, before it's everlasting too late.